स्टार्ट है। ठीक
नमस्ते एवरीवन, आई वुड लाइक टू स्टार्ट विद अ प्रेयर। गुरुर् ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णु गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरा गुरुर्साक्षात् परब्रह्मा तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयम् उदीरयेत्। आई एम साईराज किरण नागबोध, वन ऑफ द डायरेक्टर्स ऑफ ऋषि वाटिका। प्रणामास्तु श्री डॉक्टर रवि प्रकाश आर्याजी, स्पीकर ऑफ द डे, and to all the enthusiasts who have joined us live on the Rishi Vatika YouTube channel today. Welcome to Dr. Vedavyas Memorial Online Lecture Series being conducted by International Institute of Vedic Sciences, Rishi Vatika, and promoted by Vedavyasa Bharati Trust, USKFI, and Yoga Brotherhood of America, with the blessings of our Pooja Guruji, Dr. Vedavyas. Welcome back, Raviji, for another talk in the lecture series. The topic of the talk today is the Vedic calendar system. Sri Raviji is going to walk us through the science behind the Vedic calendar system. The Vedic calendar is an astronomical calendar based on the movements of heavenly bodies like planets, stars, and our galaxy. The Vedic scientific tradition of time calculation is based on the science of astronomy. So Raviji is going to explain us more about that. I would first like to briefly introduce Rishi Vatika. Rishi Vatika is a township with about 50 acres of land near Madanapalli in Chittoor district of Andhra Pradesh. It is the campus for International Institute of Vedic Sciences, which has been established for scientific and spiritual evolution of mankind. IVS primarily focuses on Vedic education, research in Vedic sciences, education and promotion of Sanskrit, Ayurvedic medicinal plants, planetary study, as well as rural development, environment preservation, and some green earth projects. Rishi Vatika houses a Gurukul school with about 50 students, as well as a Goshala with about 30 cows. It is jointly promoted by Vedavyasa Bharati Trust, USKFI, and Yoga Brotherhood of America. I would like to introduce Sri Raviji, the speaker of the day. Dr. Ravi Prakash Aryaji is a renowned Vedic scholar, philologist, historian, and a philosopher. He is a prolific speaker and a writer. He has delivered over 350 talks on various topics of Vedas, Indian history, linguistics, philosophy, culture, and scientific Indian heritage in various countries across the world. He has delivered numerous talks both on radio and TV in India, as well as many other countries across the world. He has participated in more than 75 national and international conferences and seminars in India and abroad. Dr. Ravi Prakash Ji is doing pioneering work for preserving and propagating the universal and scientific Vedic heritage of India under the auspices of Indian Foundation of Vedic Science. He has so far produced over 64 research papers and 38 books, running into 44 volumes on various aspects of Vedas, Indian history, and culture. He has also convened 3 international conferences and 4 national conferences, again under the auspices of Indian Foundation of Vedic Science. I would now request Sri Ravi Prakash Ji to start the lecture for the day.
Namaste everybody, Tain Ji, Gadadhar Ji, Padmaja Ji, and all everybody who is listening this talk. In fact, today we will be talking about the Vedic calendar system, that is the most one of our cherished projects of the foundation, and now the same calendar is being published by International Foundation for International Foundation of Vedic Sciences, working under Vedavyas Memorial Trust. In fact, Vedic calendar, from during Vedic period itself, this calendar was developed. And we, everybody know that there are six Vedangas. One of the Vedanga that is known as Jyotish. And Jyotish is known as Kala Shastra, the Shastra of time. Jyotish in ancient period, it was not developed for the sake of astrology, but for it was a pure science, and it was a science of time or a time calculation system. Similarly, in Puranas, we find the subject, one of the subject matters of the Puranas has been described as a Manvantara. This Manvantara is nothing else but the principle of time that was dealt with in ancient India or the Vedic period. In fact, during Vedic period itself, the Greenwich of the world was the Ujjain. Ujjain was the Greenwich of the Vedic period. And this 0 degree longitude, it was called as a Lanka. And it used to pass through this Ujjain, Kurukshetra, Rohtak, and like that. So this Lanka, where Ravana's capital city or this country was located, it was on this Lanka. So the Ravana's capital was also known as Lanka. So Lanka is the 0 degree longitude, and it used to pass through India. And this Ujjain, we have in Ujjain the Mahakal temple. Mahakal temple is not the Shiva's temple. It was the time determination factor. From Mahakal, from this place, the latitudes and longitudes of other places, they used to be determined, and accordingly the whole system developed in India. The places falling to the east of 0 degree longitude, passing through this Ujjain, they used to be known as Surya Vanshas. And places to the east, west of this Ujjain longitude, they used to be known as Soma Vanshis. So Ram was a Surya Vanshi, and Pandavas in Delhi, they used to belong to the Soma Vansh or the Chandra Vansh. And this whole system spread over the whole world. Today also we find, while we discuss the linguistics, we find that there are two types of the races in the world, Hamitic races and the Semitic races. These Hamitic races, they are all Surya Vanshis from India, and Semitic races, they came out from the Chandra Vanshis of the Indians. Similarly, in languages also, we have Semitic languages as well as Hamitic languages. So this Semitic and Hamitic, concept of Semitic and Hamitic has been borrowed from India itself, from Surya Vansh and Chandra Vansh. So the entire Indian system, it was quite scientific, and this is how we used to calculate time and other factors. In fact, the most important thing that today, even today surviving, is the Sankalpa part. If we read the Sankalpa part from north to the south of India, it is the same. And Sankalpa, the main aspects of the Sankalpa part, they can be read as Adya Brahmanur Dvitiye Praradhe Shweta Varaha Kalpe Saptame Vaivasvata Manvantare Ashta Vinshatitame Kali Yuge Kali Prathamacharane. Like that we are reading this Sankalpa part. And this Sankalpa part has two aspects. First one is the calendar aspect. It talks about the time. It tells us the time. It describes the time since the origin of creation till date. And the second aspect, it deals with the geography, where some function or the ritual is going to be conducted. So these two aspects, and if you go throughout India, and if you just match the Sankalpa Pathas from north and from south, you will find out the same statement. I have gathered Sankalpa Pathas throughout India, and I found that there is no such difference of time system. So the time system or the calendar system that was developed in during Vedic period, it is coming to us in a very intact form without any changes or modifications or this type of system. So this Vedic calendar is the most important aspect just to know about the time calculations. And whatever Vedic calendar we are developing, that is based upon Sayan Ganana. There are two types of calculations. One is known as Nirayan, and another is known as Sayan. Nirayan means where the precession is zero, but the precession is changing. Every 71.5 years, 71 and a half years, there is a 1 degree precession takes place. And how this precession takes place, I will also explain in my lecture. So now I start with the Panchang, because in Indian system, the calendar is called as Panchang. Why the calendar is known as Panchang? Because the Indian calendar, it deals with five things, five aspects of the calendar are there. Number one, the var. Var means weekdays, what we know. And tithi. Tithi, this Amavasya, Purnima, and similarly the Shukla Paksha, Pratipada, Dvitiya, Tritiya, like these are the tithis or the lunar days. And third one is the nakshatra. Nakshatra is the 27th part of the ecliptic, because the whole ecliptic is a 360 degree circle. And if we divide that ecliptic into 27 parts, so the one nakshatra comes, because there are 27 nakshatras. So the 27th part of the ecliptic is known as a nakshatra. And fourth aspect of our Panchang is yuga. Yuga means the sum of the longitudes of sun and moon. Their sum is known as yuga. Yuga means combination. How, if we are going to combine the longitude of sun and moon, that becomes yuga. So that is how a yoga is also equal to 30 degree and 20 minutes each. And the fifth aspect of the calendar is Karan. Karan means half a tithi, half of the tithi. If we divide the tithi by two, that Karan will come. So these yoga and Karan, they all belong to the tithi system, the lunar days. But what the calendar, the World Vedic calendar that we are publishing, it has many aspects, because now these days these Western scholars, they used to blame that Indians, they know only the lunar, they had only the lunar calendar or the lunisolar calendar. They never knew about the solar months. And solar months were invented by the Europeans only. So keeping this one of the accusations by the Western scholarship, we developed our calendar based upon solar months also. In Yajurveda and Taittiriya Samhita, we find the names of the solar months. The first solar month is called as Aruna. Second is known as Aruna Raj. Third is known as Pundarik. And fourth is known as Vishwajit. This is how the names of the solar months are there. So we started our calendar. The first column is the Christian months, because this January, February, these are very popular months. So we put it in the first column. And in the second column, we put the weekdays, the war, what I have cited here. And the third column, we have the Vedic solar months. And the fourth column, we have the sunrise time, because sunrise time has also a great importance while determining the tithi system. If sun rises on a particular tithi, then that tithi is considered or taken into consideration. And if there is no sunrise in a particular tithi, that tithi is expunged. If a particular tithi has two sunrises, then that tithi is repeated, and that is known as vriddhi, tithi kshaya. So the sunrise time is also important. So similarly, the tithis we have given in our calendar, and tithi end time has also been given. The moon signs, they have been given, and the constellations have also been given in this Vedic calendar. And lastly, we have given the festivals, events, or any anniversary falling on different tithis. So the Vedic calendar, what we have developed is the revival of the ancient system. And this revival was quite important so far as Indian culture is concerned, because the system that was developed by Vedic seers, it was forgotten with the passage of time, and the scholars, they started leveling accusations that the Indians or the Vedic people, they never knew about the solar months. So our calendar, we started it with the solar months. Now I'm just proceeding further. The Vedic calendar, it has, or the Vedic time calculation system, it has micro units of the time as well as the macro unit of the time. It started with Truti, and Truti is the 33,750th part of a second. And mostly in calendars, we use the period of Ghati and Pal. One ghati is equal to 16 palas, and one pal is equal to 60 vipalas. But today, because we are using the second minute and hour system, so they can be converted into second minute and hour system. They have been converted in this calendar for the comfort of the readers, so that they may understand it easily. And one ghati is equal to 2.4 minutes. One pal is equal to 2.4 seconds. So this is how these things have been used. And every Vedic calendar, it has day. It has a calculation of days. So there are many types of the days. One type of the day is known as a civil day. And civil day, it depends upon the rotation of Earth around its axis. We know that the Earth rotates around its axis with a speed of 1600 kilometer per hour, and the total time it takes to complete one rotation is 24 hours. So, eastern and western part of the Earth, they face sun equally for 12 hours each, and the lighted part is known as the day, and the dark part is called as night. So both day and night, they together are called as Ahuratra. The term Ahuratra finds its currency into the Hura system. In fact, the English hour is evolved from the Sanskrit Hura hour. So the day and night caused by the rotation of Earth, they are known as a civil day, and their duration is 24 hours or 60 palas. So this is a civil day. And now the next unit of the time, day, is the solar day. Solar day is based upon the revolution of Earth around the sun. When Earth revolves around the sun, it goes at a speed of 1 lakh kilometer per hour while revolving around the sun, and the time to complete one revolution is 365.25 civil days. Means this 1 year, this is known as 1 year. So 1 year of the solar, 1 year of one solar year is greater than one civil year by 360, by 5 days, you can say. Because 1 degree revolution of Earth on its ecliptic is known as solar day, 1 degree revolution. And one solar day that way is bigger than one civil day by 21 minutes. So the time of one solar day we can call as 24 hours and 21 minutes. But the time of one civil day is equal to 24 hours. Similarly, we have a synodic day. We have a tithi also, or lunar day we can call. All these lunar day, synodic day, or lunation, they are technically termed as tithis. And this tithi is formed based upon the revolution of moon around the Earth. The time taken by moon in her revolution of 12 degrees on its path is known as one tithi, one lunar day, or one tithi. When the moon revolves around the Earth, when it completes the 12 degrees on its orbit, that 12 degrees period, that is known as a tithi or a lunar day. We know that on Amavasya, sun and moon are at same place, means their longitudes of the sun and the moon are equal. They are at one place. Afterwards, the moon starts increasing her distance from the sun. And when it maintains an increase of 12 degrees, that is known as one tithi. So we may also say that tithi is the time taken by moon in increasing her distance from sun by 12 degrees. Motions of the Earth and moon keep varying in speed. So the length of the tithi constantly alters. The average length of a tithi is 23 hours, 30 minutes and 28 seconds. And greatest length of a tithi is 26 hours, 6 minutes and 24 seconds. And the least length of a tithi is 34 minutes and 24 seconds. So this is how the mean average length of a tithi is taken, and that is around 23 hours and 37 minutes. Similarly, while dealing with the tithis, we face a concept in calendar as tithi kshay or tithi vriddhi, as I told earlier. We all know that the day breaks with the sunrise. When there is a sunrise, the day starts. So the Indian calendar says that the day starts with the sunrise. But the modern concept says that the day starts by the 12 hours of the night, means 12 o'clock. At the when 12 o'clock night, ends, and further we start, the next day starts. So that is calculated as 01, 02, 12:30 is known as 0:30. And so that period we consider as the start of the day, but the Vedic system, it says that the day starts with the sunrise. So the tithis, they are also based upon the sunrise system. A tithi is also considered or calculated when it has a sunrise time. If there is no sunrise on a particular tithi, it is not taken into consideration as a tithi, and that is known as tithi kshay, or it is expunged. We don't calculate it into the calendar. Suppose on Pratipada, the first lunar day of the Shukla Paksha, there is no sunrise. So we are not going to count that Pratipada. Then we will be counting the Dvitiya Tithi like that. It takes or the earlier Tithi we count for that. If there are two sunrises, there are also chances that one Tithi may have two sunrises. Then that is known as Tithi Vriddhi, and that same Tithi is repeated. Generally, in 12 lunar months, there are 13 expansions, tithi kshayas, and 7 repetitions of the tithis. Now, one more tithi is there that is known as sidereal day, nakshatra tithi. The rotation of Earth on its axis relative to a star. When Earth rotates on its axis relative to a star, that is known as tithi. Time to complete one rotation relative to a star is 24 hours and 15 minutes. The 4 minutes shorter, this time is 4 minutes shorter than the solar day and 15 minutes greater than the civil day. Now the second unit of the calendar, next unit of the calendar is a nakshatra. As I told you earlier, the 27th part of the ecliptic is known as a nakshatra. Although in Atharvaveda describes 28 nakshatras, but 27 nakshatras have been taken into consideration because the 28th nakshatra is far away from ecliptic. Only those nakshatras have been taken into consideration which are within some 15 degrees within the ecliptic. And if that 28th nakshatra is far away from ecliptic from the plane of ecliptic, so that has been not taken into consideration. And 27th part of the ecliptic, that is 13 degree and 20 minutes. This is one length of a nakshatra or time which the moon or any other heavenly body requires to travel over 27th part of ecliptic is also called a nakshatra, we may call it. So greatest length of the moon's nakshatra is 26 hours, 32 minutes. Mean length is 24 hours, and the least length is 22 hours. This is how the nakshatras have been calculated. Now the Karna, as I told you earlier, Karna is half of a tithi. Karna is the half a tithi or time during which the difference of the longitudes of sun and moon is increased by 6 degrees. There are 30 tithis. So there are 60 karanas, because karan is equal to half a tithi. If there are 30 tithis, so there will be 60 karanas. And out of those 60 karanas, there are four fixed karanas. Four fixed karanas. First one is the Shakuni. This karan is the second half of the Krishna Chaturdashi. Or we can say this is the 58th karan. Second name of the fixed karan is Chatushpad. This is the first half of the Amavasya, because every tithi will have two half, first half and second half. So karan, a tithi has two karanas. So first half and second half. A tithi will be divided into two halves in while calculating a karan. So Chatushpad is the first half of Amavasya, or we can say 59th karan. And Nag, there is third fixed karan that is called as Nag. And this Nag is the second half of the Amavasya tithi. So first half of the Amavasya is Chatushpad, second half of Amavasya is Nag. Similarly, the first half of the Shukla Pratipada, that is known as Kistugna Karan, Kistugna Karan. So these are the four fixed karanas, and rest there are seven karanas. They repeat eight times. Each karan repeat for eight times. So they are known as Vav or Bhav, Val or Balav, Kaulav Karan, Taitil Karan, Gar or Garj, Vanij or Vishti, Bhadra. So they repeat eight times, and they cover karanas from the second half of the Shukla Pratipada, second karan you can say, up to the first half of the Krishna Chaturdashi, 57th karan. So they repeat. These are the karana system. And now I just highlighted in the beginning, the yoga is also there. Yoga is the period of time during which the sum of the motions of sun and moon is increased by 13 degree and 20 minutes. And there are 27 yogas, as because their length or their period is equal to the period of the nakshatra itself. So there are 27 nakshatras and 27 yogas. And these 27 yogas, I have given their name: Vishkambhaka, Preeti, Ayushman, Saubhagya, Shobhan, Atiga, Sukarma, Dhriti, Sula, Ganda, Vriddhi, Dhruva, Vyaghat, Harshana, Vajra, Siddhi, Vyatipat, Varyas, Parigha, Shiva, Siddha, Siddhaya, Shubha, Shukla, Brahma, Mahendra, and Vaidhriti. These are the 27 yogas. But in Vedic calendar, because this yoga and tithi system, it pertains to yoga and karana, it pertains to the tithi itself. So we have not given these things. And from this yoga and karana, one thing becomes very clear. Several scholars say that the astronomy was borrowed in India from Egypt, but no Egyptian calendar, no European calendar will be using this yoga and karana system. We are not dealing with the tithi only, but the half part of the tithi also we are dealing in calendars for the accuracy of the things. And we are dealing with the yoga system also, just to make the calendar more accurate, our calculations more accurate. The entire Vedic system, entire world, you go entire world, you find out the calendars. None of the calendars of any country, they will be dealing with karana, they will be dealing with yoga or nakshatra also. Even nakshatra, none of the calendars in any of the country, in the calendars of any of the country, this nakshatra system is dealt with as it is dealt in within India. And the second thing, the first aspect or the first anga of the panchanga is var. What is weekdays? how the week days are calculated. This is also a very scientific system. We know 7 days constitute a week. In fact, 7 days chosen to constitute a week were named after the seven planets that influence the atmosphere of Earth the most. And this sequence of the seven planets from heliocentric point of view is because all these planets are revolving around Sun. The Sun is in the middle. So closest to the Sun is Mercury, then Venus, then Earth. Earth has its moon around it, and then Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn. And if we change this setting from heliocentric to geocentric, what we will find? We will find Earth in the center, then Moon, Mercury, Venus, Sun, Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn. So this will be the sequence of the seven planets. We know that one day is equal to 60 ghatis. 60 ghatis is one day, or 24 hours. One day is 24 hours. So if we count all these planets 60 times, and the 61st ghati will come on a particular planet, then that day will be known as by the name of that calendar. Because the first day starts with the sunrise. So the first day, first var is known as a Ravi var or the Sunday. So the sun will be the maker of the first var. After that, you count in descending order the 60. Sun will be the first, second, third, fourth, fifth, seventh, 8th, 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th, like that you go on counting from left to right. And when 61 you will reach, it will be the moon. So that day will be known as Monday. Similarly, after counting 61 again, we will reach at Mercury, and that will be known as Tuesday, Wednesday. So this sequence of the 7 days of the week, or seven varas, was evolved into India based upon this pattern. Now, one calendar has after var system, calendar has the paksha, Krishna paksha, or Amavasya, Shukla paksha, and Purnima. So, 15th tithi of a Krishna paksha is called Amavasya. Amavasya is a point of time when longitudes of the sun and moon are equal. Revolution of moon around the earth, it causes the Amavasya. And moon, while revolving around the earth, it goes by a speed of 3,683 kilometers per hour, or 2,288 miles per hour. So, Amavasya, this Krishna Paksha is the waning moon, we can call. When nights following sun set are dark, the moon being below horizon. That is known as Krishna Paksha. Similarly, we have the Shukla Paksha or Purnima. The 15th tithi of a Shukla Paksha, it is called Purnima, the point of time when sun and moon are 80 degrees apart or opposite to each other. That is known as Purnima. Revolution, it also takes place due to moon's revolution around the earth. And waxing moon, when nights following sun are illumined and the moon being above horizon, that is known as Shukla Paksha. Now, after this Krishna or Shukla Paksha, we have 12 months. 12 months, this system of 12 months was also decided by the Vedic seers. During Vedic period itself, the ecliptic, the circle or the path of 360 degree was divided into 12 parts or called rasis, zodiac signs. The Rigveda says Dvadash Pradhayas Chakram Ekam. This ecliptic is a wheel of 12 spokes. So also at another place in Rigveda, we find Dvadasharam Nahi Tadzaraya Varavarati Chakram Paridhama Ritasya. That is, wheel or circle of 12 spokes has surrounded the sun, which is not going to wear out. These 12 spokes were known as 12 months, 12 adityas, 12 rashis. If we divide 360 degree circle by 12, the quotient is 330 degree. So number 30 formed the unit of a month. A month constituted of 30 civil days, or 30 solar days, or 30 lunar days, or 30 sidereal days. It was known as month. But now we have seen that year, the period of a year was mainly decided by the revolution of Earth around the sun. And it takes 365 days and some 6 hours to complete one revolution. But the period of months, who is the maker of months? The period of month was decided by the moon, Chandrama, while revolving around the sun. That is why the Indian calendar, Indian made their calendar as a lunisolar calendar, lunisolar calendar. There was a synchronism between lunar months and the solar months, lunar year and the solar year, because the Veda says, Aruno Masa Krita Vrikaha. The illustrious moon is the maker of months. And this very mantra has been further elaborated by Yaska. Arunaha Aruchano Masakrita Masa Nam Chardhamasa Nam Chakarata Bhavati Chandrama Vrikaha. That is, this illustrious moon is the maker of months and the four nights. In fact, the very name Mas has been formed or has been derived from the Mas, from the Mas suffix of Chandramasa. Mas became Mas, and the Yask says, why Yask gives the etymology of Mas. It says Masa Manat. Since moon measures the constellations in the sky, so the action of measuring is associated with moon. Similarly, in Greek language also, the moon is so called because it measures. So the action of measuring is associated with moon. That is why it is known as Mas. The same concept of measuring with regard to the moon was inherited by Greeks from Bharat. That is why they also see the measuring action behind that term moon. And the mantra says, the Vedic mantra says, Nakshatranam Upasthe Soma Ahitaha. This moon is located in the laps of the constellations because it measures the constellations. That is why we do measurements of the constellations. Nakshatra also we count in the Vedic calendar. Now these months, lunar months, they have two types. There are two types of lunar months, and both types depend upon the revolution of the moon. Lunar months, that is known as synodic month also. Lunar month is a period of time between two successive moons, means from full moon to full moon, or from new moon to new moon, from Purnima to Purnima, or from Amavasya to Amavasya. That is known as synodic month. In other words, one can say that it is the time of moon's synodic revolution, completion of moon's series of her successive phases. It is also called Chandra month. The time of Chandra month or synodic month is 29 days, 12 hours, or 29.5 days. Similarly, the solar month time is also there, because that is also measured according to the revolution of Earth. And the average time of a solar month is 30 days, 10 minutes, and 30 seconds, or we can say 30.43 days. Now, the difference between solar and lunar month, that is most important, because Vedic calendar deals all these things. Solar month is greater than lunar month by 12 hours, 10 minutes, and 30 seconds. Thus, with the passing of one solar month, when one solar month passed, lunar month falls short or stands in excess of 12 hours, 10 minutes, and 30 seconds. Or you can say 0.9 days. Thus, every 30 minutes, one lunar month stands in excess. वेद मासो धृत व्रतो द्वादश प्रजावतः वेद मासो धृत व्रतो द्वादश प्रजावतः Vedaya upajayate. Knower of the natural laws knows the 12 months and the intercalary months. So this was the system. Now, sidereal month also, there is also one type of month that is known as sidereal month, and that is also based upon the revolution of the moon. Sidereal month is the time taken by moon to complete one orbit of the earth with respect to a constellation. In fact, this sidereal month, it has been considered in the Vedas. When Vedas, they talk about or they describe a month, they talk about a sidereal month and not neither synodic nor the solar month. According to the Vedas, the human biorhythm equals the motion of the moon. So human menstrual cycle synchronizes with the sidereal month. There are numerous quotations in the Vedas that talk about the birth of a child in the 10th month of the conception. For there is mantra, Dashme Masi Sutme. So these 10 months means 10 sidereal months of 27 days each, and not the 9 solar months. And one of the most important thing, the Vedic calendar, it gives the names of the month. The names of the month, that is most important. Chaitra, Vaishakha, Ashadha, Bhadrapada, like that. How these names of the months have been given, and everybody of us knows that there, these Chaitra, Vaishakha, Purva Bhadrapada, Ashadha, Jyeshtha, these months, name of the months have been given after the names of the nakshatras. But there are 27 nakshatras and the months are 12. So how come from 27 nakshatras, these 12 months, name of the months have been selected? This is the most important or the moot point to know. 12 solar months are called, in fact, these months, the Vedic months, name of the months, they may be solar months and they may be lunar months also. Solar months means from one Sankranti to another Sankranti. Lunar months means the revolution of the moon around the earth, one revolution. So solar months are called Meshadi and lunar months are called Chaitradi. This is the difference. There is a different principles for naming Meshadi and Chaitradi month. The names of the months will differ when calculated from Meshadi method and Chaitradi method. The names will differ quite. There will be a lot of difference. That is why in Indian history, when we find out the mention of a month, it becomes difficult to know whether that month was named on the method, on the pattern of Meshadi system or the Chaitradi system. So we shall have to decide, and that becomes a matter of further research. Solar months are named as per solar Sankranti, intervening two Amavasyas, means from two Amavasyas, between two Amavasyas, when some Sankranti takes place, some solar Sankranti will take place between two Amavasyas, and the solar Sankranti taking place in a particular nakshatra, so that Purnima will be known by the name of that nakshatra. The lunar months are named after the names of the nakshatras coming in conjunction with moon at the end of Purnima. At the end of Purnima, when a particular nakshatra will come in conjunction with moon, so on the basis of that nakshatra, the lunar month, name of the lunar months will be given. And for your kind knowledge, in our calendar, we have used the lunar months. We have used the system of naming months according to the Chaitradi system, because we have given solar months a different name according to the Taittiriya Sanghita and Yajurveda. But this Chaitra, Vaishakha, Jyeshtha, Ashad, they can be used as the names of solar months and used as the name of the lunar months. In our calendar, we have used these months as lunar months. So their names have been, their calculations have been done as per the Chaitradi method of calculation. So this is a different. Had we used these names for solar months also, then the month, solar months would have differed from the names of the lunar months. You just see, when between two Amavasyas, a solar Sankranti, a sun Sankranti takes place in Mesha Rasi. Between two Amavasyas, when sun Sankranti takes place in Mesha Rasi, then that Purnima will be named as Chaitra Purnima. And that month will be named as Chaitra month. If it takes place in Vrishabha Rasi, then the month name of the month will be Vaishakha. If it takes place in Mithun, then the name of the month will be Ashadha. This is the solar month naming system. If it takes place in Karka Rasi, then the name of the month will be Ashadha. This is how the whole pattern was developed from Mesha to Mean. And if between two Amavasyas, a solar Sankranti takes place in Mina Rashi, the month will be named as Falguni month. Now, coming to this lunar month, in Surya Siddhant, a rule has been given, a principle has been given, and Surya Siddhant says, Kartikyadishu Sanyoge Kritikadi Dvayam Dvayam Antyopantyau Panchamasya Tridhamasya Trayam Smritam. When at the end of Purnima, the moon comes in conjunction with Kritika and Rohini, either of these two, the name of the month will be Kartik. When it will come in conjunction with Mrigshira and Ardra, the name of the month will be Margashirsha. When it will come in conjunction with Punarvasu and Pushya, the name of the month will be Pausha. So mostly, two nakshatras have been given one month's name. But there are three places where nakshatra, Purva Falguni, Uttar Falguni, and Hasta. When moon comes in conjunction with Purva Falguni, Uttar Falguni, and Hasta, the month will be named as Falguni. Similarly, if moon comes in conjunction with Revati, Ashwini, and Bharani, the month name will be given as Ashwini. And if it comes in conjunction with Shatvishak, Purva Bhadrapad, and Uttra Bhadrapad, name of the month will be known as Bhadra. So this is that system. And now one more thing is there. There are two patterns of naming months. Purnimant and Amant. Means from Purnima to Purnima. Month ends, the lunar months. Or from Amavasya to Amavasya. These are the two systems. In fact, the Purnimant, Purnima. Purnima means when the month is going to be complete, Purna. So this system was adopted based upon this etymology. When the month is going to complete, that is known as Purnima. And Purnima month, they start with the following Krishna Pratipada and ends with Purnima, 15th day of the bright moon. Similarly, this pattern was prevalent in North India. It also was prevalent in South India up to the beginning of the 9th century AD. And Amant month, ending in Amavasya and starting with the following Shukla Pratipada. It will start with the Shukla Pratipada and end with Amavasya. So this system was more prevalent in South India. So these are the two systems of naming month. I have given here some calculations that is not so important. So Adhikamas and Kshayamas. That is also one of the important feature of the calendar, because sometimes we have two Chaitra, we have two Vaishakh like that. So Adhikamas system is also there. So every method has a different type of calculation system for Adhikamas or Kshayamas. Solar month is greater than lunar month by 12 hours and 10 minutes and 30 seconds. So passing of one solar month, a lunar month falls short of 12 hours. Thus, every 32 solar months and 15 days, one lunar month stands in excess. This excess month is called Adhikmas. I have already pointed this fact. And Meshadi, in Meshadi method, if there are two Sankrantis between two Amavasyas, then the month arising out of the second Sankranti is expunged. The month so expunged is called Kshayamantha. On the other hand, when there are no Sankranti between the two Amavasyas, the previous month repeats itself. This repeated month is called intercalated month or Adhika Mas. Similarly, there are ayanas, two ayanas, Uttarayana and Dakshinayana. Uttarayana means the Makara Sankranti. Sun's Makara Sankranti is Uttarayana, and these days it takes place on 22nd December. And Sun's Karka Sankranti is known as Dakshinayana. And these days, it takes place on 21st June. From 22nd December to 21st June, this period is known as Uttarayan. Because during this period, the northern hemisphere of the earth, it starts facing the sun. And from 21st June to 22nd December, the southern hemisphere of the earth, it starts the facing moon, or we can say that sun starts going down, coming down to the south of the earth. And during Uttarayan period, sun starts moving towards the north side of the earth. So that northward movement of the sun is known as Uttarayan. And that southward movement of the sun is known as Dakshinayana. Similarly, there are two more things, Vasanta Sampat and Shishir Sampat. That is known as vernal equinox or autumn equinox. In other way, words, we can say Mesha Sankranti, 21st March, and Tula Sankranti, 23rd September. So these Dakshinayan and Uttarayan, these two ayanas are also the most important part of the Indian calendar. Why they are most important part? Because Indians always hailed the rising of the sun. In Gayatri mantra also we see, mantra says, Tat savitur varenyam bhargo devasya dhimahi dhiyo yonah prachodayat. Savitur varenyam, we concentrate, meditate upon the luminous light of the sun. And this light of the sun, dhiyo yonah prachodayat, it inspires our intellects, our minds to do various jobs. When sun rises, the people, they engage themselves doing various duties, and during night time everybody takes rest. So the lighted part of the sun, the sun has a great role in Vedic system, because with the help of the sun rays, the whole creation on earth takes place. Had there been no sunlight, had there been no sun, there would have been no life on the earth. So the Vedic scholars, they could understand the importance of the sunlight. In fact, this Agnihotra, the cosmic Agnihotra, is taking place on the earth. And earth has been described as a Vedi. Etavati vai Vedi yavati prithvi. The parameter of fire altar are as much as this, as the parameter of the earth itself. And the sun rays falling on the earth, they are just like the fire burning in the fire altar. And this whole yajna is, creation yajna is going on. So the Indians, they had importance. They gave importance to the sunlight. And Uttarayan is a period when in northern hemisphere, the day, the length of the day starts increasing and the length of the night starts decreasing, and this period is known as the day of the Devas, Devon ka din. Why? This south and northern pole, north pole and south pole. North pole is known as the Devalok, Sumeru, and south pole of the earth is known as Danavalok or Kumeru. And it is said when there is 1 year of the humans, human, this equator is known as Manushya Loka, because the maximum population of human beings, it resides around the equator. So equator is known as Manushya Loka, and it is said the 1 year on Manushya Loka has 1 day on the Devaloka or Danavaloka. So Taittiriya Sangita also says, the Devanam Yadaha Manushyanam Tadavarsham. Because on polar regions, there is a day and night. There is a day for 6 months and there is a night for 6 months. So the Devaloka, so the day of the Devas is known as Uttarayan. And we celebrate this Uttarayan because it is the day of the Devas. Why? Because in northern hemisphere, we will find, we will get more sunlight. But in Vedas, we have both the systems. We have Dakshinayan system also, when the year was started with the Dakshinayan. Why? During that period, during Vedic period, when the landmass of the India, it was in the close to the southern pole, close to Australia. We were to the south of equator. By that time, we used to celebrate Dakshinayan as Uttarayan, because the people living in the west, this southern hemisphere, they will have their bigger days only during Dakshinayan period. So Uttarayan is being celebrated because in Devaloka, in northern hemisphere of the earth, the sun will give its more light during this period. And 21st June is the day when the days are the longest and nights are the shortest. After that, the period of the day it starts reducing and the period of night it starts increasing. So this Makar Sankranti, but today we are celebrating Makar Sankranti on 14th January, not on 22nd or 21st December as it takes place. This is, we have highlighted these all things in our calendar as historical Makar Sankranti because 22nd December is the up to date, the current position, according to the current position of the nakshatras, the planets, we have this one. But if the precession is taken as zero, now the precession is not zero. The ayanas, even the panchangas made on the basis of the sthir ganna, on nirayan ganna, all the panchangas in India, they are being made on the basis of nirayan ganna. And these, from those panchangas, we will come to know that there is a ayanans of 23 and 5. 23 and a half degree ayanans is there. Means this 23 and a half degree precession has taken place. So whatever 24th January happened, it happened some 1600, 1800 years back, because 1 degree precession takes place 72 years. If we multiply from 21st December to 14th January, there is a precession of some 14 plus 9, 23 days, you can say. And if you multiply 23 by 72, that period, 1600, 1700 years period, behind them, during that period, this Makar Sankranti used to take place. But today the Makar Sankranti, actual Makar Sankranti, we have described the actual features as astronomical. Astronomical Makar Sankranti is taking place on 21st December. So this is the difference in our, we have given in our calendar. Similarly, the Dakshinayan and Uttarayan have been given. Now I have just given an idea of the Dakshinayan and Uttarayan through this. This 23 and a half degree north, this is the farthest point in the northern hemisphere where sun rays fall on earth at 90 degree. And this 23.5 degrees south, that is known as the Makar line of Capricorn or Makar Sankranti or Uttarayan, this is this one. So when sun moves from this Makar line of Capricorn towards the line of Cancer, this period is known as Uttarayan. And when sun comes down from the line of Cancer to the line of Capricorn, that is known as Uttarayan. Similarly, there are two more very famous words in Vedic calendar that is known as Devayan and Pitriyana. Devayan period, when sun remains in the northern hemisphere for 6 months, means on 21st March, sun comes on equator, and after that it moves towards northward, and on 23rd September, it comes again on equator. So from equator to equator in the northward direction, sun remains from 21st March till 23rd September. This period is known as Devayana. Similarly, from 23rd September till 21st March, when sun is in the southern hemisphere, that period is known as Pitriyana. Pitriyana means the darkest period, that is known as Pitarloka. So the year also, we have lunar year, 12 lunations are equal to one lunar year. Its average length is 354.367 days. Similarly, solar year is the period of Earth's orbital revolution. That is time during which the annual seasons complete their course. presently it is called Varsha. Presently we call year as a Varsha because literally Varsha means shower of rain or measured by rainy seasons. There was a time when the year was measured by rainy season. So we call year as a Varsha. But during Vedic period, you might have seen the mantras where the year was measured by Sharad season. Jivema Sharadha Shatam, Shinuyama Sharadha Shatam, Prabravama Sharadha Shatam. So that Sharad Ritu, that Uttarayana was named as the year. Because by that time, year started from Sharad to Sharad. But there was some time when the year started from Varsha Ritu to Varsha Ritu. But presently the year is being started from Vasant Ritu to Vasant Ritu, from in different phases, the different starting points of the year were there because it was because of the location of the landmass of India in various directions. When India was in southern hemisphere, the year started from Dakshina. When we drifted to the equator, our year started from Vasanta Sampat. When we drifted towards this Uttarayana, the year would start from Uttarayana. So this is how the position of Indian landmass used to change the naming of the year system. Similarly, this the sidereal year and tropical year. Sidereal year is the period during which the earth makes one revolution round the sun with reference to a fixed star. That length of the sidereal year is 365 days, 6 hours and 9 minutes. Tropical is the period during which the earth in its revolution round the sun passes from one equinox or tropic to the same again. Means from one Sankranti to another Sankranti, we can say it makes the return of the same season to any given part of the Earth's surface. The length of the tropical year is 365 days, 5 hours, and 48 minutes. It is shorter than the sidereal year because the equinoxes have a retrograde motion among the stars, which motion is called the precession of equinoxes. Its present annual rate is 50 degree or 50 minutes, we can say. Now, what is this precession? This we shall have to understand it. Just like the earth is rotating on its axis and revolving around the sun in the universe on its ecliptic path. What happens? Just like the top, you will have a top. You just play a top. The top will oscillate from one side to another side. So Earth also oscillates from one side to another side. And this oscillation of Earth, what it makes, it pushes it towards the westward. Westward means, and this push of the Earth's equinoxes to the westward is known as precession. Due to gravitational pull of the sun and moon, Earth's axis rotates westward, causing celestial and equinoxial points recedes westward at the rate of 52.2 minutes per year. Or 1 degree or 1 day's precession takes place in 72 years. Complete cycle of precession takes place in 25,920 years. So this is how we can calculate the time also, because we find mentioned in the Vedas that a particular Kritika Nakshatra was rising on the horizon on a particular in Shatpat Brahman. During Shatpat Brahman's period, the Kritika Nakshatra was rising on the horizon, but presently we have Purva Bhadrapada Nakshatra rising on the horizon. So that is how we can calculate the time from Kritika to Purva Bhadrapada. How much precession is there? We can multiply by 72 and we can find out the time of Shatpak Brahman from today's point of view. So this is all happening. Calendars, actually this is a very big explanation. After Yuga system we have, after year we have Yuga system also. 5-year Yuga system, the biggest, the smallest Yuga system was dwelled on the basis of the sun and moon in Dhanishtha constellation. When the sun and moon, they used to come in Dhanishtha constellation, then the first 5-year Yuga system was developed, evolved. And I have given here this calculation, 365.25 sidereal year divided by 27.25 sidereal month, and this is equal to 13.40. Or if we multiply it by 5, it comes exactly 27.01. Means 67th time meet exactly in Dhanishtha Nakshatra with a 1 degree difference. So accordingly, the 5-year Yuga system was evolved. According to the Vedanga Jyotish, every 5th year, on the first day of bright half of Magha month, when Earth's northern hemisphere tends towards sun, sun and moon get conjunct with Dhanishtha constellation. Swarakramete Sumarko Yadasakam Sava Savau Shat Tadadi Yugam Maghastapa Shukle Ayanam Ishudaka. And similarly, the 12-year Yuga system was also developed. We know that Jupiter, it takes one revolution of the moon, of the sun in 12 years. So accordingly, the 12 years Yuga system was developed as per, based on the revolution of the Jupiter. When Jupiter comes in Kumbh Rashi, and it again comes in the same Rashi, Kumbh Rashi, in 12 years, that time we celebrate the Kumbh Mela, the Kumbh festival. This 12 years Jupiter Samvatsar, this is known, this has been described in our Vedic calendar. Similarly, because the Jupiter orbits around the sun every 12 years, so 12-year Yuga was evolved owing to the Jupiter's orbital period around the sun. Similarly, Shukra, Venus, is known as the Guru of Asuras. People residing in the western hemisphere, it rises in the west and sets in the east. And this Jupiter, Brihaspati, is called as the Guru of the Suras, Devas, people residing in the eastern hemisphere. Because Jupiter, like the sun, rises in the east and sets in the west. So because Jupiter was the guru of the, Brihaspati was the guru of Suras, so on the basis of the Jupiter's revolution around the sun, we developed a 12-year Yuga cycle. So Bahraspatya Samvat, we called Bahraspatya Samvat, sir. There are 60-year Yuga cycle. To extend the limit further, the 5-year Yuga was studied with respect to the Jupiter. So the limit of Yuga was extended from 12 years to 60 years. Because 5-year was with moon's conjunction and sun and moon's conjunction in Dhanishtha Nakshatra, it evolved 5-year Yuga system. When this 5-year Yuga system was combined with Jupiter's 12 years, it made 60 years Yuga system. And according to Vishnu Dharmottar Purana, quoted in Vallal Sena's work called Adbhut Sagar, Magha Shukla Samarambhe Chandrarakau Vaswarakshagau Jiva Yukto Yadashatam Sashtyabdadis Tadabhavi. The 60-year Yuga cycle commences with the conjunction of Jupiter with moon and sun in Dhanishtha constellation on the first day of bright half of the Magha month. The 60-year Yuga commenced for the first time when conjunction of Jupiter also took place in Kumbh Rashi, Dhanishta constellation, on Magh Shukla Pratipada along Moon and Sun, after 86 crore 50 lakh years had elapsed of the present Kalpa. To celebrate the beginning of 60-year Yug cycle, Kumbh Mela is held, as I told you earlier. So, Bahraspatya Samvatsar 60-year Yug cycle is also used in our calendar. And Matsya Avatar took place in Prabhava Samvatsar. That is why Prabhava Samvatsar was regarded as the beginning of the Samvatsaras of the Jupiter year or Bahraspatya Samvatsar. And these are the 60 Bahraspatya Samvatsaras. Prabhava, Vibhava, Shukla, Prabodha, Prajapati, Angira, Bhava, like that. So the Kali Yuga started with Vijaya Samvatsar, now Vibhava Samvatsar. And Shankara's birthplace took place in Nandana Samvatsar. And Shankara died in Raktaksha Samvatsar. So this is how this 60-year Yuga cycle is there. Jupiter year Yuga cycle is there. And it has been used by us in our calendar. When it has been here described as Bahraspatya Yuga, Jupiter year, Manvantara year, Srishti Samvatsar, Brahma year. So all these systems have been used in this calendar. Brahma year has been used in our calendar because the whole creation is equal to 100 years of the Brahma. And presently we are in the second half of the Brahma's year. That is, 52nd Brahma year is going on. And that has been described in our calendar as Brahma era. Similarly, the Srishti Samvatsar has been given in the calendar because the biological creation on earth took place in the beginning of the Kalpa. That has been known as Srishti Samvatsar. And Manvantara, today we are passing through this Vaivaswat Manvantara, the seventh Vaivaswat Manvantara. So this has been given in the calendar. So this is whole the system has been given. In Bahraspatya calculation system, Bahraspatya Samvatsar calculation system, there are two methods. One is Daivi method, or used in north, propagated by Surya Siddhant. Duration of Bahraspatya Samvatsar according to Surya Siddhant is 361 point some days. Thus, Bahraspatya Samvatsar is about 4.23 days shorter than the solar year. So, in each successive solar year, commencement of the Samvatsar will take place in 4 days in advance. Thus, every 45 years or 86 years, one Samvatsar of 359 days or 363.9 days respectively will be in excess. Or say 85 solar years will be equal to 86 Samvatsaras, or 86 years will be equal to 87 Samvatsaras. As such, one Samvatsar needs to be expressed in 85 or 86 solar year alternatively to bring Samvatsaras in unison with the solar years. This method is known as Daivi method, and it prevailed in North India. Another method is known as Asuri method. It was propagated by Paitamah Siddhanta. In Asuri or South Indian method, the shortage of days in Jupiter Samvatsar with respect to solar year was never calculated and expunged. According to this method, a Samvatsar starts with the start of new solar or lunisolar year and ends with the end of the solar or lunisolar year. Next solar year, next Samvatsar is taken. So in Asuri method, the Jupiter Samvatsar has lost its naturality. But in our calendar, we have used this Asuri method also, South Indian method. So as I told you earlier, Bahraspatya Samvatsar in the beginning of Kali Yuga. According to Surya Siddhant, Kali Yuga began with Vijaya Samvatsar of Daivi or North Indian tradition. According to Paitavaha Siddhant, Kaliyuga began with Pramathi Samvatsar of South Indian tradition. And this is how we can calculate the Samvatsaras from the beginning of Kaliyuga, means 3101 BC till date on this pattern. So there is also a difference of divine and human years. According to the ancient Indian tradition, polar regions are known as Dev and Danav Lokas, North Pole being Devalok or Sumeru, and South Pole being Danavalok or Kumeru. Equatorial region is called Manushyalok or Vasuki Nag, being highly populated. In Atharvaveda also we find a mention, Vaishwa Narasya Pratimopari Dyaur Yavad Rudasi Vivabhadhe Agni Tata Shastamudamantau Yantistoma Udito Yatnavi Shastamaha. On the ecliptic, sun shines for 6 months on one part of the earth and for 6 months on the other part of the earth. This makes day and night of 6 months each on the polar region. Taittiriya Sanghita also records, Tasmar Aditya Sanmaso Dakshine Neti Shad Uttare Neti. Similarly, the 6 months day and night at polar region makes one day of the Devas, which is equal to 12 months at equator. Taittiriya Brahman says, Ekam va etad devanam ah yat samvatsarah. That is, one day of humans is equal to one day of gods. Jain Avesta of Parsis, which is the Vedic legacy available in corrupt language, also preserves the same old notion as follows. Te et ayar main ent yat yare. If it is rendered in Sanskrit, it will be read as under, Te et aharam manyante yadavarsham. Thus, one divine or dominical day is equal to 360 human days, and one year is equal to 360 human years. This whole system I have given. I don't think any other thing needs to be explained so far as this calendar is concerned. The Mahayuga system, it is also a quite elaborate system. Satya Yuga, Kali Yuga, we have given the Kali era also here, Dwapar and Manvantara system. So I think I have done a lot of elaboration on Vedic calendar, and now I sum up my lecture. Thank you.
So I think Sai Garu is having some internet issues. So let us just. Oh, he's here.
Sorry. Yeah.
No, he's back.
Yeah. Sorry for the this thing. Can you hear me, Ravi?
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks for the talk today, Ravi. It was great to know the all the. I mean, different components of the Vedic calendar. Some of the components like tithis and all are known, but there are several components that are, I mean, several aspects that are not well known. There are a couple of questions. Let me start with one question. It's by Venkat Raghavan. How can we explain skipping of three tithis in a day as mentioned in a single day, as mentioned in Mahabharata, times twice?
In fact, it all depends upon the sunrise system, sunrise time. It seems to be quite impossible. If there is no sunrise time, none of these three tithis had sunrise time, then they would be skipped. Because that whole calculation is depending upon the sunrise time and the timings of the tithi. That those period of the tithis, their starting and the ending point, if they have any sunrise, there is any sunrise on those tithis, then that tithi will be calculated. And if there would be no sunrise, then that tithi would be expunged. But the reference of the Mahabharata needs to be investigated. There cannot three tithis, it seems to be quite impossible. Those shlokas will need to be reinvestigated. What is their actual meaning? Until and unless we have those shlokas, I am not able to comment anything. Just like in Ramayanas also, the people in Rama's birth, there is a shloka, and the people, they are translating it or interpreting it their own way, but that's a wrong method. So at least I have seen that two tithis can be skipped, expunged, but third one, we will have to see that reference. But it all depends upon the sunrise. If sunrise takes place in a particular tithi, that will be taken as tithi, nor it will be expunged. If one single tithi will have two sunrise times, then that tithi will be repeated, again the same. If it is the sixth tithi, then again it will be the sixth. So that is only the method.
Got it.
Whatever is available, information available with us. During that period, have there been some, because there were some 14 Siddhantas, and today we have only Surya Siddhant extant. If some other Siddhant would have made some other explanation, maybe accordingly, we'll have to go by that. But according to Surya Siddhant, this is only the system.
Got it. Another question by Galadarji is, can you explain the India national calendar or Rashtriya Dinacharya, the Saur calendar?
Excuse me, pardon?
I think the question was, can you briefly explain about the Rashtriya Dinacharya or the India national calendar?
Okay, Indian national.
Yeah.
Actually, Indian national calendar is based upon the Shak era
system. Okay.
And Shak era is also taken as 78 AD. But there had been many Shak eras. Even 583 BC, there was also one of the Shak eras. So this system that was the national calendar that was developed in India is basically based upon a Hawks system. It's not an actual system. Only they have taken the Shak era, 78 AD, based upon the Western scholars' point of view, because they want to fit in all the dates of Indian history within, according to this era. And that is how the 1200 periods of the Indian history has been demoted. So they only consider one Vikram era, this 57 BC, but there was Vikram era 717 BC also. So Indian system is based upon, this national panchang is based upon this Shak era. And they are following this normal method only. That Narian panchang, they are following. They are not following this tropical panchang or the Sayan panchang.
Okay, got it. One more question. I think this is more general thing. The Vedic calendar system is an advanced and very scientific astronomical calendar, giving various events and so on. Why was this system not being very popular in India and the world?
Actually, if something is very scientific, it becomes more complex also. So usually the people, they want to follow a very simple system, and nobody wants to follow this because there is a synchronism of lunar days, solar year, lunar months. So the tithis, they are changing. But in Western system, this Gregorian calendar, if something falls on 21st January, it will be 21st January. But if in Vedic calendar, something falls on Bhadrapada, Krishna, 8th, so that date will continue to change. So the people, they want to follow a simple system. And because of the simplicity or easy method of calculation by this Gregorian system, the people are following it. And our calendar is more scientific. It is based more on research type of system, you can say. But had the Indian calendar system been followed through, based upon this solar month, from Sankranti to Sankranti, it would have been more simpler one. But the system that was followed, it is a lunisolar system. Because of its complexity, the people, they don't want to follow it. Because only if you will check, go through the calendar or Panchang, you will find these days. It's not easy to calculate yourself.
Got it. Another question from G.S. Raju Garu. Is there a unified calendar for the entire country? I mean, government of India has tried since independence. So what is the result of trying to unify the calendar? Are there differences between the national calendar of India and the Vedic calendar explained today?
No, actually, present day Vedic calendar that we are making, we are not going to have any clash with the national calendar of India. Because whatever these festivals or parvas they are citing, we are citing them as historical one. We are also citing them, but we are also citing the up-to-date one, the current one, based upon the planetary system. So we are citing both the systems, but we just want to make home our point that this calendar needs to be revised, updated as per Ayan Ansar.
Got it. I think one more question that just came up. What difficulties are we now facing to adopt our Vedic calendar as a national calendar? I think, again, connected to national calendar.
Actually, it depends upon the willpower of the government. Because the earlier governments, they never wanted to follow this system. And if the government wants, then they will have to constitute some committee or think over it.
Got it. One more question by Pallavi Agrawal. How can one start learning about or more about the Vedic calendar?
Actually, while going through this calendar, you will find so many things. And slowly, steadily, you will learn about it also. You can have raised questions. In fact, my co-author is Ashwini Kumar. He's from Canada. He never knew. In fact, these people, they pressurized me to bring out some calendar. And now they can do a lot of things. They are just revising it, doing so many amendments. So once you will proceed with this system, you will find out, because it's quite scientific and mathematical. It's not just some simple, it's more complex also, but it's quite interesting also. You will see even the tithi, half tithi you will consider, even the combination of two tithis you are going to consider. So it's not a small thing. It's purely based on astronomical system.
Got it. I would like to thank Dr. Ravi Prakashji for walking us through the Vedic calendar. It's very useful to know all the different aspects of it, the macro and the micro aspects of time. And it's also great to see us revive this calendar system that has been around for quite some time. I'm also very pleased to announce that International Institute of Vedic Sciences and Indian Foundation for Vedic Science is jointly publishing the Vedic calendar for 2021, prepared by Dr. Ravi Prakash Aryaji. As explained by Raviji, this is a lunisolar calendar that includes both lunar, solar and lunar months. It includes various information about the calendar system. It gives details about the planetary transits, which include both solar and lunar eclipses as well. It also provides information about Vedic health and agriculture calendar as well. Also another unique aspect of this is that we have also included the weather forecast for 2021. And this was prepared by, weather forecast was prepared by S. Ramachandran based on Vedic astronomy and Vedic meteorology. Please book your copy now. The details of this are provided in the description of the of this video as well. And for a limited time, we're also offering, along with the Vedic calendar, a copy of the book, the concise text on Vedic Hinduism. This was by our Guruji, Dr. Vedavyas. So please take the benefit. This is a very unique calendar. So take advantage of it, get a copy. Now. So once again, I would like to thank Raviji for his time today. I would like to thank all the audience who have joined us live on the Rishi Vatika YouTube channel, and request everyone to subscribe to the channel and for the latest updates, as well as all the future talks of this Dr. Vedavyas Memorial online lecture series. Thank you.
Thank you.